Yes. Yeah, this is actually a very interesting story in how the movie industry works. There is another guy on there's another guys on YouTube who actually made a video about this. They call themselves Midnight's Edge, I believe. They make all these interesting videos about the movie industry, and lately they've been talking a lot about Sony, the leaks in Sony, and Amy Pascal, who
Oh
was.
God, yeah, I heard about her.
Yeah, they talked a lot about that. Tom Rothman, who a lot of people in the movie industry are quite familiar with, has become rather infamous while working at Fox. Now, he recently replaced Amy Pascal at Sony. So,
Wow.
but and I want to talk a little bit about this guy because this guy has made some monumental, weird, questionable decisions, and he's been responsible for a lot coming out of Hollywood. What I wanted to start with was the fact that he was basically responsible for for delaying the production on the 2003 Daredevil movie with Ben Affleck, and he actually bullied Mark Steven Johnson into putting more CGI into that movie so it would look more like Spider-Man. He actually cut more than 20 minutes out of running time out of the movie in order to get more screenings and therefore more money.
And thus that movie really bombed pretty badly.
Yeah, and here's the crazy part. He did that without
Without
Johnson's
Johnson's permission.
permission. And it set back the entire Daredevil franchise, and it actually ended up being sold back to Marvel, and as we have seen with the latest Daredevil show on Netflix, that
That
was
was probably
probably a
the
good
best
decision.
decision. Yeah, I do agree because I actually liked that show. And
Yeah.
they're also planning to make I believe a new sh they already did the Jessica forgot what was that show again?
Jones, Jessica Jones.
Jessica Jones. And now they're also planning to do a I believe another Marvel series, which is Luke Cage and
That's coming
Iron
out in a
Fist.
that's actually coming out in a couple of months. They're coming out with Luke Cage in September, I believe. So we get two
And
Marvel shows.
yeah, and also Iron Fist, I believe. That was I always liked Luke Cage and Iron Fist together as a duo, because they always seem to work pretty
Doing
well
with it.
together.
Here's what they're doing with the Netflix shows, right? They're making, you have Daredevil, you have Jessica Jones, and then you have Luke Cage and the Daredevil season two and Iron Fist, and I believe they're making Jessica Jones season two. I'm not sure about that. I don't think so, but I know they're planning to end it all with making the Defenders, which is basically like all of these characters together,
And Heroes for
stopping.
Hire.
Yeah, they're teaming up, in the final show that they're making. But I gotta say, I have not disliked any of these shows. I actually like Jessica Jones a lot. I didn't expect to like
I
it, but I
kind of
actually
liked it, the
ended up.
villain. I kind of liked it, the main villain that was played by I forgot his name.
Yeah, the guy who used to be Doctor Who. Yeah.
Yeah, because he
He's
did a
creepy.
better job of being a villain than he was.
And he's this creepy guy, and he's this really disturbing, creepy motherfucker. Yeah, I mean, the shows on Netflix have really, had a great success, and deservingly so. But I wanted to get back a little bit on the
Yeah,
Rothman
I'm
issue.
sorry about that. Go ahead and continue.
Well, then you have the X-Men's Origins Wolverine and the Deadpool issue.
They did a
And got
lot
into.
of they did a lot of CGI for that movie, and I seen the CGI version of it, which I'll admit unofficially.
Well, here's the thing, right? Rothman got into a dispute with the director Gavin Hood on the direction of X-Men Origins Wolverine, and Gavin, who was fresh of an Academy Award-winning film, wanted a gritty, grim, violent version of the character, more in keeping with the comic book as it was based on, while Rothman wanted a brighter, more colorful movie that would be able to appeal to a wider demographic, even going as far as to hire a contractor to tear down and rebuild a set in accordance with his vision for the movie while Gavin Hood was away for several days on a family emergency. This is the kind of dick this guy is,
He doesn't
to the
really give a
point.
shit about creative freedom of the
Yeah,
director.
to the point where Gavin Hood actually left the movie unfinished. And the movie was ghost directed by an unnamed director. Rothman was the one who mandated that some artistic liberties be taken with the character Deadpool. He's the one who sewed Ryan Reynolds' mouth shut in that movie.
That's interesting.
Yeah. And there's also a rumor regarding Ryan Reynolds and Tom Rothman that Reynolds actually did not want to play Deadpool in the latter half of X-Men's Origins Wolverine, and that a stuntman played him because he disagreed with what Rothman did to the character. And when Ryan Reynolds came to him with the CGI test footage, the famous Deadpool test footage as a pitch for the character, where he actually says in the test footage at the end, "Hi, Tom," Rothman rejected it out of spite for Reynolds.
Because Reynolds said, "Hi, Tom. You remember me?"
No, because all of it, because Reynolds apparently had a feud going on with him after the X-Men's Wolverine movie, where he refused to play the character in X-Men's Wolverine, and that a stuntman actually played him in that movie.
Oh,
So
okay.
there's a lot of rumors floating around about
Yeah,
that.
because I remember that part of the movie where he was, they took out the face, they took out the mouth of the character.
We're not even getting into the nitty-gritty part. Then we have X-Men 3, The Last Stand. And this is where things get really interesting. Rothman not only rejected the first draft of the script of that movie with the Sentinels in it because he believed that giant robots were too fantastic for a mainstream audience to accept. This was less than 2 years before the Transformer movies would prove him wrong, by the way. And while he says that, there are theories that he believes that Rothman rejected the script and delayed the production of X-Men 3 because he had a grudge against Bryan Singer. Because back in 2000, he wanted the first X-Men movie to fail so the studio could get a tax write-off, and the movie was such a big hit and got a sequel. Rothman didn't exactly take it too well, and the movie was delayed again and again and again. Eventually, Bryan Singer, tired of the delay Rothman put on his movie getting greenlit, left Fox to work on Superman Returns for Warner Brothers. This compounded with Rothman needing to get the movie made in order to for Fox to keep the rights, resulting in X-Men 3 getting rushed into production. And you want to know why the Dark Phoenix storyline, which Singer had been setting up in the last two X-Men movies, was butchered the way it was? Because Rothman did not care about the material, and his grudge against Singer, delaying production of the movie, is what ultimately turned X-Men 3 into the jumbled mess it was.
Is he also responsible for the Hulk?
I don't think so.
Because
I don't
I
think so.
seem to recall, a lot of people were upset. I remember one of the actors left because of the because they found out that there was some plot line to the storyline to the comic that would lead to the other the other things. I can't remember which actor it was. Norman. His name. I keep
I mean, he's
forgetting
been.
people's names.
Yeah, I mean, it's I'm not sure. I haven't found anything about that. I think a lot of the stuff from Rothman right now, and he was recently. I mean, he replaced. There's been so many crazy comments regarding. You can if you basically just Google Tom Rothman's name, you'll find a lot of shit, and here, yeah. And it's like, and then you have Fantastic Four, of course, which was a fucking disaster.
Yeah, because I remember that, and they were trying to promote diversity in that movie, but they kind of ruined it by putting a black actor into the movie, and it was like, yeah, great idea. Hopefully Michael B. Jordan would be the right actor, considering he had tried to play in several roles that didn't turn out well. Like, just hope he did okay with Creed. That was an okay
Yeah, but
movie.
here's the thing though. Here's the thing with Thomas Rothman. I'm gonna bring up NeoGAF. I know that a lot of people don't like NeoGAF, but
Yeah,
I
I
this was
understand.
back. But I gotta bring him up because the first comment was on NeoGAF when they had a forum post about this. This was back, I believe it was announced in February that he was taking over for Amy Pascal at Sony. And what was interesting about this is the first comment on that thread on NeoGAF was, "Are they trying to tank their film division? Nobody likes this guy. Nobody who enjoys comic book movies likes this guy because, or in general, because this guy. Keep in mind, Tom Rothman actually fought against James Cameron on Avatar. He was not a big fan of that movie because he didn't think the movie would be profitable." And
Boy,
you
he
know
was wrong. He was so wrong.
he's been wrong on so many decisions. And his I mean, when Fox when Fox made Deadpool, that was like that. I mean, a lot of people were actually hoping this movie would be terrific, just to rub it in Rothman's face. And you know, the movie made, I believe. We're talking $700 million. The movie had a budget of 56 million. That's a big win for Fox
Yeah.
because this was a movie nobody at Fox had any hope in. But
Yeah,
Ryan Reynolds.
and I heard Ryan Reynolds did the movie despite the fact that he was black. They said that he was blackmailed. That was according to rumors.
I gotta say though, I mean, there's even a funny story that Rupert Murdoch actually warned him of being too much of an autocrat. And when Rupert Murdoch tells you that you're too much of an autocrat, you may want to tone down the evil just a little bit.
Yeah,
And
and he fucked up so many times. It's like he's not gonna be able to understand why people like to watch different types of movies that you don't like.
well, it's also an interesting story. I mean, in addition to rejecting Singer's X-Men 3 script, Rothman also rejected Peyton Reed's, the future director of Ant-Man, I might add, proposal for a Fantastic Four movie that was closer to the source material. He was also the guy who put pressure on Tim Story to make Galactus a cloud in FF, Rise of the Silver Surfer, much like with the Sentinels thing. Also believing that a giant purple planet eating man was too fantastic for a mainstream audience to accept.
Yeah.
So there's, I mean, if I mean, I just want to say to everybody listening, if you want a deeper investigation into the poison that Rothman kept injecting into his movies, I highly recommend you check out a video by some guys on YouTube called Midnight's Edge. They have a video called Deadpool: The History of Fox's Mismanagement. And it's a very fascinating video who I highly recommend checking out because these guys do some amazing work on their videos and they really dug in to the Fox issue. They also made a couple of videos on the Ghostbusters thing and they made a couple of videos on Batman v Superman and all the shit that has happened inside Warner Brothers. They really are taking the movie industry to town in their videos and they are very, very analytical. And they go into a lot of shit that tells you a lot of things about the movie industry that I think a lot of you suspected, but this is like, wow, you won't believe the hostility between some of these people. The reason why I wanted to bring this up now, especially about Rothman, is because, you know, he's involved with Sony right now, and he's currently overseeing the MCU connected Spider-Man movies.
Oh,
And
God.
recently, Spider-Man, this is a very weird thing because the new Spider-Man movie was announced and its title is Spider-Man Homecoming. And the problem is that is that Robert Downey Jr. is actually attached to this movie, and Tony Stark is actually going to be in this movie. And
Why would he want to come? Why would he want to be attached to this movie? When, for what reason? Well, in the script?
Well, here's I don't know that this may be connected to Civil War, but here's what's really strange about all of this. Spider-Man Homecoming is very much a Sony Pictures production, while they have the Marvel logo on it. And Marvel, as you know, has its own studio. They make their own movies under ownership of Disney, right? So this seems to be a Sony Pictures production, but they still have the Spider-Man Homecoming logo, and they have the Marvel logo attached to it. And now that Robert Downey Jr. has confirmed that he will be in the Spider-Man reboot. So this is weird. This is fucking weird. From a production standpoint, it's like, and I have no idea why they would do this. It seems so
especially,
weird,
especially when they fired one of their actors that did the Amazing Spider-Man movies, and it was said that he had Andrew Garfield, I believe. And they decided to make a new one out of the fact that they're going to put in a new character. I wonder who that character is going to be, who the actor is going to be. Sorry.
Well, here's the thing, right? Because right now, according to somebody I spoke to online, it seems like Sony and Marvel and Disney and Sony has kind of like a two-way street deal when it comes to this. They are cooperating right now, and they have some sort of licensing deal with each other. And that seems to be what they're going for and how they are resolving this. I mean, it seems to be a lot of bureaucracy involved in making this movie happen. And I don't like the fact that Tom Rothman is the guy at Sony who is responsible. That makes me, because he's been called an autocrat. He's been described as somebody who actually manages studio in a terrible manner, and it's just amazing that this man is currently at Sony, and you know, he also had a lot to do with the Ghostbusters reboot.
And I showed you that one, and I was surprised that he would want to make this movie, and not even realizing that the fans who watched the original one are gonna be like, I don't want to watch this movie is kind of like, but you know, I understand that families want to show this to their kids, and it's not a big deal. It's just that people are gonna probably watch it and wonder why this is not the same as the original Ghostbusters movie. Because from what I understand, you told me about the script last time.
Mm-hmm.
You told me that there's going to be... Gozer's going to be a dragon in this... the script was leaked, by the way.
Oh, yeah. Let me tell you some other stupid shit that apparently Rothman has been responsible for. A movie that nobody asked for. A 22 Jump Street crossed with crossover with Men in Black. I am dead serious. This is something that you're considering.
I wouldn't want to watch that one.
Who the hell asked for that? I'm sorry. Who?
I don't know.
And there's an article in the Hollywood Reporter right now about several filmmakers are said to be leery of working under Rothman's detail-oriented management. So a lot of people are kind of like, oh, I don't know. Because he's infamous, especially among directors and people who work in the movie industry. He's pretty infamous.
Canceled Firefly.
Yeah, that's the guy. This is the guy that canceled Firefly.
I hate that guy so much. That was like one of the greatest shows That's one of my the best. I mean, I got to give it to Joss Whedon on this one. That's possibly one of his best works.
And the funny thing is, he canceled Firefly, which the fans liked, but yet he's making the Ghostbusters movie, which the fans dislike.
Yeah. Also, Tom Rothman seems to be enjoy pissing people off as well, because he's trying to Ghostbusters critics dissed by Sony head in Epic Rant. This is from Cinema Blend.
Yeah.
Here's what he wrote. Everybody says I'm making the female Ghostbusters, but I'm saying no, we're making the funny Ghostbusters. Yes, it happens to be four women. Let me finish, Leon. Yes, it happens to be four women. It's original. You get pissing and moaning on the internet, sexist comments, but you know, fuck them. That is what Tom Rothman basically told critics of the movie.
You know what? I gotta say one thing. He wants to make shit. All I gotta say is, let him make shit. I'm not gonna watch it. I won't give Sony a single cent for making a shitty movie.
Yeah, I just pray he doesn't get involved in the TV shows, because Sony does produce some TV shows as well.
How zero to fire would he be after this movie flops?
I don't know.
It's going to flop big time. They have talented actresses. They have comedic actresses. And here they go screwing up a good premise.
Well, you know, it's going to be... I am going to go see the Ghostbusters movie, because I am morbidly curious about it. I am going to go see it because I want to know, is this as bad as I think it is? And I'm actually hoping this movie is so bad that I actually can laugh at it, that it's become so bad it's actually a wonderful kind of movie.
Yeah.
But you know, I'm interested in seeing how Sony has had a lot of had a string of failures lately, and Warner Brothers also has not been doing too well, while Disney is on a fucking roll.
They did okay with Superman.
I mean, like it or not, with the Star Wars movies, I mean, it was brilliant. I mean, like, for instance, the actors and stuff, they have good actors for those movies, but the whole diversity bullshit that they pulled is the reason why the characters don't match up.
What movie?
The new Star Wars one that just awakens.
Well, you know, here's the thing about that. I am very conflicted on Force Awakens, because I adore Daisy Ridley as Rey. I adore her. I think she is terrific in that movie. I disagree with a lot of people when it comes to her. So I like John Boyega. I like Oscar Isaacs. I really do like these characters. I want to see episode 8 before I make a final decision, because after seeing them in two movies, then I can make a decision on their character. I don't want to jump the gun.
Here's something I'm going to point out. They just leaked the script.
Oh man, I gotta say I gotta say something else, like a wrestling fan stuff. If you think about Star Wars and stuff in the same categories like wrestling, there's a wrestler named John Cena. Everybody's heard of him. There's no way you couldn't have heard about John Cena. He's just right, like 100% wrestler. Everybody hates him for it. So I'm just going to say it like this. If they keep making Rey a 100% perfect, like the Star Wars equivalent to John Cena, people are going to hate that character more than Jar Jar.
Well, here's the thing, right? I mean, John Cena, great wrestler, horrible actor. I gotta say, I want to go back to a little bit on the Warner Brothers issue, because you know, you take a look at Warner Brothers and Sony Pictures, they have both not done so well lately. Fox had a big hit with Deadpool, and ironically, after Rothman left, Fox is finally realizing that firing Rothman was probably one of the smartest decisions they ever made. But I gotta say, Disney has also been on a winning streak lately. I mean, take a look at, I mean, you had The Jungle Book, which came out a couple of weeks ago.
I heard that was a good one. I want to see it.
I want to see that movie. I unfortunately have not seen it yet. Everybody is telling me that it's great. And I have seen almost no negative reviews for that movie. It has a 90% fresh rate on Rotten Tomatoes. The audience loves it. The critics loves it. This is great. And then you have Captain America Civil War, which is getting rave reviews. I'm seeing it this Wednesday. It's coming out this Wednesday here in Norway. So I'm looking forward as hell to seeing Captain America Civil War because that movie looks brilliant. Yeah, I mean, it's like I'm not even a Marvel fan. That's the worst part. I was so excited for Batman v Superman, and it turned out to be a steaming pile.
Oh God, I've watched that. It's like, heck, what's his name? The one who directed Zack Snyder. What he did is something that I would expect to see from M. Night Shyamalan, not him.
Fun fact about Batman v Superman. Apparently, the movie has been less profitable for Warner Brothers than Man of Steel.
Oh,
and Man of Steel was considered by Warner Brothers to be a underperformer.
I didn't like all of Man of Steel, but there are certain things in it I got. There's good parts in it, mostly it was shit.
I had this huge argument with Andrea Dahl because Andrea Dahl thinks Man of Steel is a fucking masterpiece, and it's not a masterpiece.
Destroying 90% of Metropolis was just like, no, the fact that they brought Zod in immediately, like having Zod, instead of like saving him for like how they did in like the originals, was like Zod didn't come into like later on. Like
they did the same mistake with Batman v Superman, right? You had Doomsday showing up just for the hell of it in that movie. He had no reason to be in that movie.
He should have been like one of their ultimate villains in like a Justice League movie. Doomsday would have been that one that you Superman, yeah, that I heard about that and I'm like, what the hell? I was like, and then it's like, oh my god, are they that stupid?
Yeah. Well, here's the thing, right? It's going to be, there's been so many weird decisions being made by the film industry, and it's crazy to think how much influence this one guy has had on two major studios. And I've had Tom Rothman has been responsible for some horrible decisions in Fox, and now he's basically tanking Sony's Pictures division as well. Which is just—it's just amazing to see this because it's like, really, you looked at Fox and Fox is doing a lot better now without him than they did with him, and you guys at Sony decide, let's hire this man who fucked Fox for so long. This is the guy that argued with James Cameron about Titanic. You know, it's like, yeah. Well, he has made some good decisions, but here's the problem. He's when it comes to genre movies, he's not very good at it. And he has had some successes, but the problem is that he started getting involved with a lot of the comic movie stuff, and he does not understand that market at all. He doesn't know what the audience wants. I mean, Warner Brothers made the same mistake with Batman v Superman, where they basically thought that all the audience wanted was action, 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 action. And when that failed, it's been such a weird time. You know, people are really starting to vote with their wallets. And, you know, it's like, because there's so much entertainment out there, right? There's so many movies coming out. I mean, especially it's a superhero movie genre. There is just so much stuff right now.
Yeah.
But it's also kind of funny when you look at Warner Brothers, how this has settled one classic argument between DC decades, and that is one argument that I'm finally glad. Who is popular? No. Who is more popular, Superman or Batman? And Batman is clearly the most popular character. It's basically Warner Brothers was basically got a shit ton of emails and a lot of tweets from people who said, when's the Affleck Batman standalone movie going to happen? Is it going to happen? When are you making it? So they got so much people asking for Affleck standalone Batman movie, and I'm not it. But I'm like, fuck, you know, I feel bad for Henry Cavill because nobody gives a fuck about Superman. Everybody wanted to see the Batman. And I love the fact that Turkish Airlines actually made two commercials from Batman.
So how was Wonder Woman in the movie?
Gal Gadot, she was okay. Great, nothing terrible. But I think she basically has so few lines in this movie that she barely makes an impact on you at all. I mean, she's basically the sexy hot chick that sort of does buy stuff for half of the movie. And at the end of the movie, she basically shows up in full Wonder Woman getup just because. And I don't know. So she's basically just she's a throwaway character in this movie. She's basically used to set up the Wonder Woman movie. And that's it.
And I heard the Flash was total shit.
Yeah,
I like the show The Flash. Have you watched it? It's like, it's still one of my favorite shows.
I gotta say one thing though. It's really interesting that Warner Brothers now recently announced that they are actually re-releasing Batman v Superman, the extended cut, on a theatrical release. I have never heard of this happening before. A movie that is just cinemas is being re-released with extended scenes.
Okay, it's just like I'm a fan of DC. I think I have more of a love for DC than I do for Marvel, because let's just face it, their superheroes are far more iconic. Superman, Batman, Wonder Woman, far more iconic than Iron Man, Captain America, Black Widow.
Well,
Scarlet. I'm trying to say they're far more iconic.
Yeah, but here's the thing, right? The argument was basically who was more iconic of Batman and Superman, and Batman clearly wins because it was like the Turkish Airlines released two commercials from Batman v Superman. They had the Fly to Gotham and Fly to Metropolis. Guess which one was more seen on YouTube and was voted as the most popular one?
What, Fly to Gotham? Batman is a much more interesting hero, though. He's far more interesting. He's like a Batman. It's that mysterious character. And just Superman, like how I talked about, like Daisy Ridley's character in the new Star Wars movie. It's just too of a perfect character. Like, for instance, with John.
I'm gonna point out something about Batman. Superman. A lot of people don't like Superman because
he's too perfect.
No, he's not perfect. He's too much because he cares about people, but at the same time, he's a dick. He has to be a dick sometimes in order to do what he has to do. A lot of people, heck, there's a website dedicated to this. A lot of people don't. Heck, my friend does not like Superman, but he always reads the comics.
I remember Angry Joe. He's a Superman fanboy if you've ever seen it. You see every one of his videos, he'll have a Superman shirt on. But the problem with it, like, I always consider the John Cena term, like with Ray from Star Wars and Superman and stuff like that, they're too perfect. And, John Cena, continue for something here. People don't like completely perfect. People like characters with flaws.
And Superman happens to have flaws too.
But they don't really focus. Like, for instance, this movie, did they have kryptonite in the movie?
Yes, they did have kryptonite in that movie.
Okay, that.
But the funny, but the funny thing was, he was flying, trying to stab Doomsday with the kryptonite.
No, but that's just like the problem with the movie, though. The characters are too perfect, and fans don't like perfect anymore. It's just that point. It's like they're almost like immortal, except for Kryptonite with Superman. Everything else is in. It's just like, oh, Superman's that immortal superhero. It's like, I don't want to watch an immortal. I want to watch somebody that has struggles.
You have to realize in the Man of Steel, he did have struggles. He had a struggle trying to deal with his powers as a human being. Because he would rather live as a human being than a.
But this is what I'm trying to get at, though, with Superman. With Superman, he's just. That's why people like Batman better. It's just.
Well, you have to realize something. One, he has a hard time struggling being nice to people, because at times people treat him like shit when he acts like a human being, but when it comes down to it, he didn't go after the guy. He went after the guy's truck in the movie. You might remember the Man of Steel. He didn't want to get pissed off at the guy because he didn't want to hurt him. You have to realize Batman does not want to kill people. He wants them to understand, you don't know who you're messing with, buddy. Don't hurt me. I'll hurt you and make you I'll break your bones just as easily. He doesn't want to do that. He doesn't want to abuse his powers over people. That's the type of Superman he is.
I was just trying to get that.
Well, I just wanted to make some final points about Tom Rothman, because that is what we actually got in here to discuss. I think this will be an interesting time for Sony Pictures coming ahead, because I think the stakes because everybody keeps saying that, oh, there's no way Ghostbusters will fail as a movie. No, there is actually, after looking at how Batman v Superman did, there is a big chance that movie might fail, because you have to remember the production cost of this movie is $150 million. And if they can't make that money back, because they are projecting how much money they could potentially make with this movie. And if this movie is popular in its launch weekend and all of a sudden it dries up the second weekend and nobody bothers to go see it and everybody says the movie is shit, then yeah, that is not going to be good news for Sony. And I hope that will be the end of any potential Ghostbusters movie ever again. I didn't even want to see a Ghostbusters reboot to begin with.
I'm hoping this will be the end of what's his name as well.
Tom Rothman?
Yes.
But I do feel kind of bad for Paul Feig, who is the director. He's not a bad director. He actually, when he gets the right project, he's actually can make a Ghostbusters wig is funny. I do think Melissa McCarthy can be funny, and
funny. Melissa McCarthy's funny. They're funny women. Kristen Wiig could be funny at times, but they're poorly casted. You could get the best actor in the world or the best actress in the world, and they could just be shit.
Keep in mind, we're basing a lot of this on what we saw in the trailer. And the idea here is that a lot of people are saying, oh, it's a bad trailer. That doesn't mean the movie has to be bad. And that is true. This could be a shitty trailer. But the reality is that if the script leak on Reddit is true, which a lot of people are confirming now that it is, because the guy who leaked that script has leaked other stuff from Sony before. So if the script is true, it looks like it is, because he mentioned a lot of stuff that actually ended up in the second trailer. So I was like, Oh man, the guy on Reddit was right. If the script is any indication on what this movie is going to be like, then I'm worried, because that doesn't sound fun at all. It sounds cheesy. It sounds like a comedy that appeals to the lowest common denominator, and it's not funny.
Look at the movie Battleship. I mean, I watched in theaters and I'm like, hey, maybe this will be a good movie. Totally complete shit.
I honestly did not expect that movie to be in any good in any way, shape, or form.
I went to watch it and like, you know what? Maybe it'll just be a mindless action movie. It wasn't even rightly written, and it's like, and I'm leaving. I'm like, damn, this is a waste of money. And
it's basically a recruiting ad for the U.S. Navy.
and it did so shittily. Everybody's like, I didn't even know that was a movie. I didn't even know that movie was even playing. And I'm like, really? And it's like they've been advertising the shit out.
Well, here's the thing, right? The projections was that they were here's what they originally projected, according to financial analysts. What they originally projected was $1.3 million, and if this and the worst case scenario that Warner Brothers had was $1 billion, that the movie barely made it past the $1 billion mark, and it's nowhere. And it doesn't look like that at all. It doesn't look like to even be close to that. And so they lost quite a bit of money. And people are saying, oh, this movie is doing so well. No, it's not. No, it's not at all.
Lost money. And it's doing shittily. And that's a good thing. If it's a shitty movie and they lose money, maybe they probably will. They probably
They have invested so much in this project already. What I am curious about is to see how the Wonder Woman movie is going to be. I mean, I don't even give two shits about that movie, because I was like, yeah, I don't know. I was like, yeah, if the movie comes out and there's nothing else to see that weekend when it comes out, I'll probably go see it. But I was like, I'm not excited anymore. The only thing that has me kind of excited when it comes to DC right now is the idea of a standalone Batman movie and Suicide Squad. Suicide Squad,
oh,
still.
Yes. Did you see that recent trailer and stuff? I love how Angry Joe, when Harley Quinn was like putting her shirt on, Angry's like, oh, blah, blah, blah. His jaw was dropping. Like,
oh, yeah, God, but here's the thing. Here's the thing about Suicide Squad. If they're going in the direction which I think they're going, and they are light-hearted tone, but still being like gritty, then I'm all for it. I'm hoping Suicide Squad is a bad movie. I don't want these movies to be bad. I want them to be good. And it looks like Suicide Squad looks to be a very funny movie, and I hope it is. I hope it's the movie that I think it's going to be, which is, that there's going to be a lot of tension between the villains and Batman is going to pop up. I hope that happens, because I'm more of a Batman fan. That's why I like the idea of a Suicide Squad movie. But at the same time, I'm thinking, how can they screw this up? And all of these ideas just pop into my head on how they could possibly mess this up. So it's going to be interesting. It's going to be interesting to see. That movie is out in August. Right now I'm actually I have the movie, my movie ticket for Captain America Civil War on my phone, so I'm looking forward to seeing that this Wednesday. So there's a lot of stuff coming out. I gotta say this though, from a movie perspective, I think the Marvel Cinematic Universe has such a head start on the DC Cinematic Universe that it's going to be almost impossible for them to catch up unless they have a huge hit on their hands. And they're not off to a good start with Batman v Superman or Man of Steel, for that matter. They have made two mediocre movies, and none of them have really been raised in any way. So, DC need to get their shit together and fast, because Marvel has spent over a decade creating their cinematic universe. And they have spent so much time in building this up, and they really, the people behind this, they really give a damn about the things that they're doing. And that's why, I mean, when you have, you say that, you say, I mean, I know that a lot of people say that Superman and Batman are two very iconic characters, but keep in mind the generation who grew, who were kids during Iron Man 1 and 2 and 3, and who were kids when Captain America came out, they are going to love Captain America. I mean, I believe it was one of the guys who was the son of one of the guys who wrote the original comic for Captain America back in the 1940s. He was a character that was created to boost American morale during World War II, right? He never expected that character to make a reappearance in pop culture again. And now he's incredibly dumbfounded to see children walking around with Captain America t-shirts. So us older guys, you know, I'm gonna be 30 years old in December, as much as I hate to acknowledge that. So I gotta say, I'm getting older. The kids today, they grow up with all these superhero movies. I mean, I'm just thinking what a great time it would have been to be a kid now, watching all, being a kid, and you know, because they're gonna grow up with a lot, seeing a lot of these movies. Batman v Superman was never really a movie that was intended for a lot of kids, because the movie is so long and dreary, and so is Man of Steel. It's not a kid's movie. While Captain America Civil War is and can be seen by children. And so that's, it's incredible to see that a lot of kids are walking around with Iron Man t-shirts. So the idea of Iron Man not being as popular anymore, yeah, amongst our generation, sure, but there is a lot more children out there who love these characters now, and their opinion matters more than we think, especially when it comes to demographics. And then you have the people who are Marvel fans in general. So I think that, and DC, I love DC, but they have made so many shitty decisions. I think the good things about DC has been the Batman Arkham games. That they have been great.
Okay.
And the fact that the DC universe right now is in a bit of a turmoil. They don't seem to know what they want to do with it. I mean, the New 52 was a fucking disaster. Now they're coming out with a new version of the DC comics called Rebirth, which nobody really wanted. And
that's like trying to say, okay, we fucked up, we might as well start over again.
That's, yeah, for the third time.
One thing about this, so just as a fan, I like the DC, I like Marvel. I don't give a shit about either. I don't care which one's on top, which one's not. But just putting this in hindsight, I want to see them both succeed. I want to see success for both of them. They screw up, I don't even know if we'll ever get to see a good A. You know what I would have wanted to see originally? I would have wanted to see them mix like their TV show universe, like the Arrowverse characters, like the stuff from Green Arrow and stuff like that from those shows.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I would.
Tomorrow. I mean, seriously. That is still like one of the best shows I've seen in a long time.
This is where Marvel actually has made some of the better decisions, because every single TV show out there right now that has the Marvel, that it uses a Marvel franchise, you know, you have Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., you have Agent Carter, which is a show that I actually liked quite a lot. And maybe it's because I think Hayley Atwell is absolutely gorgeous. And, you know, and you have the Netflix shows. What's interesting about these shows is that all of these characters are in the same universe. This is part of the same universe. While a lot of the DC shows are in their own separate universe. And if they actually manage, and that's why a lot of people got pissed off when it came to Flash in Batman v Superman, because he was not the Flash from the TV show. Yeah, the one that people like. So if they could have actually worked a little bit to make sure that fit into the canon or into the continuity of the actual universe, yeah, I think that could have been a better decision. But here's the problem. Here's where DC completely botched it. Marvel had planned this in detail I mean, they set up the whole Marvel Phase 1, Phase 2, and Phase 3 thing. They had all of this worked out before they started doing this shit. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is you know, every single season has ended with a Marvel movie, you know, right? You have, this season is ending at the same time Captain America Civil War plays out, right?
I remember the first one started with Thor. I believe that was and then they did the Avengers, and that's when it all happened.
Yeah, and decisions that, and what's great about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is that, you know, after Captain America, the Winter Soldier, you see a lot of the stuff that happens where the entire S.H.I.E.L.D. is basically exposed as a Hydra, and the whole organization goes belly up, and you see how that affects the characters in the show. You have the continuity between the TV show and what happened in Captain America. You actually see the consequences of what happened in the movie in the TV show. That is fucking brilliant how they wrote it, and it all fits. That's what Marvel has really done great, is connecting all of these different stories into one big arc. Even Guardians of the Galaxy is a part of this cinematic universe.
And I wonder how they're going to try to put Fantastic Four into this universe, because you remember you remember how Galactus came in out of nowhere, how they would implement it.
Well, I forget his name, the guy who played Star-Lord,
Chris Pratt.
He's going to be in the Infinity War movie, the Avengers Infinity War.
That's going to be good.
And that makes a lot of sense, because in Guardians of the Galaxy, you see him get one of the orbs, right? And he has one of the Infinity Stones. And in Age of Ultron, you see the Vision have another one of the Infinity Stones. And this is all tied together to one character, and that is Thanos. And Thanos is the guy who is basically... He's
Thanos.
Thanos.
It's okay,
He's the guy that basically connects this entire universe together. He's the main villain that everybody's afraid of. He's the main villain that the guys in Guardians are need to take care of.
That started the thing in Avengers too. So
yeah, I mean, he's part of all of this, and you know,
to bring in the story of the Infinity Gauntlets, which makes him the most powerful being in the universe. That's going to be a difficult story to tell.
Well, they have been setting the story up now for the past 5 years, so they're taking their sweet ass time. I mean, it was like everybody was like, why can't we say Thanos yet? I was like, hang on, they're building up to it, and now we're starting to see it come together. So, the Avengers Part 1, Infinity War Part 1, that is going to be the first part of that story. And it all makes sense, because in the entire Guardians of the Galaxy thing, right, the whole orb thing, that contains one of the Infinity Stones, right? And that is what Thanos wants. He wants he wants to gather all the Infinity Stones to his gauntlet. So the Vision in Avengers Age of Ultron, he has one of the Infinity Stones. And then you know that the people in Guardians of the Galaxy, they have one, so there is three more stones out there.
Oh yeah.
I have a feeling they're gonna try to do the same thing with Iron Man, because he probably found one of the stones.
Well, he technically did, because the Vision, which is essentially, you know, it's the Jarvis, gets implanted into the body at the end of Avengers Age of Ultron.
Yeah, that's true.
He has the Infinity Stone in his head. He has it implanted in his forehead. So that's one of the Infinity Stones. And Thor, the new Thor movie, Ragnarok, or as we say in Norwegian, Ragnarok, it's a Norwegian word. Yeah. And it basically means Armageddon. And that movie will also focus on the Infinity Stones, because Well, I'm actually looking a lot forward to Avengers: The Infinity War Part 1. I'm looking forward to seeing all of this tied together into one epic battle. I'm excited to see a lot of this. I mean, I didn't like the last four movie, but the next one looks kind of interesting. But
they're bringing up Civil War, which I believe that one's like the mutant registration one.
Yeah, they're also having the the Civil War. I read the comics.
And they refer to them, because I know that they refer to the in the Marvel's Agents Sealed, the Inhumans, which I believe they're going to bring in a lot of Inhumans in the story.
Oh yeah, and I loved the last episode of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I had to catch up on the show, so yesterday I was doing nothing but watching Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. because I wanted to catch up on the story. I'm liking it. I really like it. And I gotta say, though, the girl who plays Simmons, the young, nerdy British scientist girl.
Yeah.
I want to wake up with her next to me, please. Oh God, I think she's so adorable. She's so
you just love her cute British voice, and you just had to you just couldn't
British girls.
No, it's that. Yeah, I mean, she has that beautiful, cute accent. You know, just imagine wait, and she has that cute face. Oh, she's just adorable, and she has her own little story arc in that show where she's stuck on another alien planet and she has to fight to survive. And there she is standing in her underwear with a spear, and I'm like, I like this.
She also fell in love with that one person.
Fitz.
Yeah, and then you find out Fitz is infected with the parasite alone.
Well, here's no. Actually, that's not him. That's not him at all. He's not infected at all. So it's a long. Let's just say at the end of the last episode, had Daisy go all evil for some reason. Because she has been infected.
Yeah.
And only Inhumans can apparently be infected by this evil Hydra monster that apparently is from outer space somewhere. I don't really know where they're going with this, but
trying to go with the Skrull thing.
Yeah.
Because the Skrulls that kind of started shit with the planet.
Well, I came on here to discuss Tom Rothman, but it was much more fun to discuss Marvel instead.
Yeah, Marvel's let's continue with Tom Rothman.
The Shield's still getting really good. I've been watching, I haven't been watching Arrow because I lost interest in that show, but I have been watching the living hell out of Flash and Legends of Tomorrow. Those two shows are freaking amazing.
I gotta watch Legends of Tomorrow. I haven't seen a single
episode. It's on Hulu.
Carl, that is one of the best shows. I mean, they have, there's a Rip Hunter. I think you probably know, I don't know if you knew which one.
Captain Cold joined them too.
Yeah. Yeah,
and Adam is in there. Yeah. So
they have Rip Hunter on here on the show.
Yeah,
and he's actually a really good actor. I know the one who plays Rip Hunter. It's actually really cool. He's not like a really big strong dude, but he is a really badass character on the show.
Oh, Legends of Tomorrow is on Netflix. Okay, now I know what I'm gonna be doing tonight.
What? Tomorrow's on Netflix?
Yeah.
Yeah. Legends of Tomorrow's on Netflix. The entire first season is on Netflix.
Really? I thought they haven't even finished it yet.
It's on Netflix here. They're adding episodes. 11 episodes is out. They're airing them on Netflix as they release on television. So
it's also on Hulu as well, and they actually.
I've been watching on Hulu. I have like a special Hulu's like thing that I do that I have on my Hulu channel, just so I could watch shows like Legends of Tomorrow and stuff. I have that commercial thing on Hulu, so I don't have to worry about the. So I could watch.
Oh, Legends. some good news from for Star Trek fans as well. It looks like the new Star Trek series will be set in the old continuity of Star Trek.
Oh, goody. I'm hoping for a good one, because a lot of people were kind of upset about it, and of course they kind of didn't like the other one that J.J. Abrams did.
Oh, God. I'm a little split on that one. My mom's friend, she's a diehard Star Trek fan. I was talking about, she says, one of the problems is that the diehard fans have, including her, is what's his name? Kane, I think it is. Khan, that's it, Khan. The original, he was this ripped dude, a big, strong guy. In this one, he's just this. He's not like anything like that. It's like low key.
I'm sorry, but nobody can beat Ricard. I think that Benedict Cumberbatch is a terrific actor. He's just amazing at what he does. But he did not fit that role at all, because nobody can beat Ricard. Nobody can beat Ricardo Montalbán.
Guess who he's playing?
On?
No, he's playing Doctor.
Strange, yeah, I know.
Doctor Strange.
So that is the Doctor Strange. What, good one or bad one?
I gotta say though, now that we talked about Khan for a little bit, is the quote from Wrath of Khan, and it's like, it's the such great. Quote, I'm gonna see if I can find it. I don't remember the entire one. Yeah, here it is. It's when Khan basically has left. That is right before Kirk goes Khan, you know, where he yells Khan.
Yeah.
And the way he says it in his calm manner with that accent, it's incredible. No. It's basically right before Kirk yells out his name. Khan basically, I shall leave you as you left me, as you left her. Marooned for all eternity in the center of a dead planet.
Buried alive. In the center of a dead planet. Because he does it with an accent. He does it with that, I will leave you in the center of a dead planet.
Buried alive. Buried alive.
They're just, I like how it's just like one of the darkest. It's really dark, and that's what I like about Star Trek, the originals. They can get dark at times.
Yeah.
I gotta say, though, the original show has not aged very well. One of the moments in the old Star Trek show that always gets mentioned is when Kirk is fighting this guy dressed up in a dinosaur suit with a staff. And that like dramatic music plays in the background. That's all. That's like the Batman. It was even made fun of in the Cable Guy movie.
I seem to recall they did a HD remake of it, like a digital. They did everything they could to save the original Star Trek, and they decided to amp it up, remaster it. I didn't like the remastered version, because especially when they tried to put in the put in that other stuff in there.
I just love the music, like dun, 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 real dramatic music.
But did you see the newer version of it, the remastered version?
No, I only watched the original show once. I could never go back to watching it twice.
I watched it twice, and I was like, okay, because I only watched the remastered version. I remember watching the original show, and the original show compared to what they did with it, they updated the special effects on that show and put like 3D graphics in there.
My favorite Star Trek captain. So it was like, Kirk was never really that interesting to me. I liked the old movies, sure, but I was like, I'm probably gonna get death threats from some Star Trek fan. I was like, how dare you? It's like, talk
how
about
dare James you, made... Yeah, Tiberius Kirk. How dare you? He was my favorite captain of all time. And then you hear people having that argument about Janeway and other captains, like Captain Luke Picard was my favorite captain.
I actually, to be honest, I actually did something that probably would have got me to the US. When I went to see The Force Awakens in theaters, I actually had a Star Trek hoodie on.
If you were, you would have been. Oh my god, that is like blasphemy, man. That is.
I'm going to the Star Wars convention in London in July. I'm thinking about wearing it again. You know, it has a picture of Picard on Gage. It's like wrong convention, dude.
but you're gonna go ahead and go in Star Wars fashion.
I have a t-shirt. I'm not sure if I'm going to be wearing anything, actually. I'm just going to wear regular clothes because I'm, you know, I don't want to walk around. I'm going out with a friend of mine later. So, yes, it's a pretty British girl. Of course it is. So, yeah.
Okay. I understand.
Who looks very similar to Simmons from The Shield? Coincidence? Probably not.
Well... We kind of gone off top. We gone off topic over this, off of Tom Roth. I forgot his name.
Senor Tom Rothman.
Yeah, Senor Tom Rothman, who tried to kill every comic movie in the world with his stupidity.
Oh God. Yeah, we kind of went off topic, but, you know, rant.
Yeah, I know. Go ahead and say what you have to say.
Well, I'm actually done discussing Tom Rothman. He's a shit person who makes shitty decisions, and we're going to see a lot more shit coming from Sony and a lot better things coming from Fox since they got rid of him. That's pretty much the summary of my argument. So,
I agree.
But I gotta take off now, man. I thought I might join you. I don't know how long we've been talking.
Yeah, we've been talking about an hour and 6 minutes.
Wow. Yeah, Marvel discussion is like 8 hours later.
Yeah, anyways, guys, I'm going to probably end this. Thank you for listening to us rant about this guy who happens to be an asshole in the industry, and hopefully you'll understand what we're talking about. Catch you all later. Peace.
See ya.
Okay.